says, try. Even if you're scared, you can't prevail if you don't try. Emily's plans after high school are to go to college, and then transfer to WSCV to get a bachelor's in elementary education. And Emily is not sure yet if she can participate in cheerleading after high school, but she hopes so. Thoughts from coach to Emily, coach says, Emily, your courage and ambition is unmatched. You can never replace the other. Ladies and gentlemen, Emily, and here. Our second senior tonight is Ari Cousins.
I vaguely remember.
Ari is the escort by Elena, the girlfriend, and Ari has cheered him for 4 years, all at Oklahoma High School, and has received the most improved athlete in 2017. Ari would like to thank Coach Val for always believing in her and supporting her, even when she was super shy as a freshman. And her favorite high school cheerleading memory was the Starlight Parade in 2018. Her advice for future cheerleaders, she says, never give up and always be confident in every cheer you do. Her plans after high school are attending Paradise Valley College in Arizona and majoring in criminal justice. Thoughts on our team from Coach says, I'm so glad you came back this senior year. You have grown so much and you have become an incredible athlete. I am proud to be your coach, Ari Cousins. Ladies and gentlemen, Ari Cousins. Our next senior tonight is Emma Holbert. Emma's being escorted by her mom, Brittany, and stepdad, Scott. Emma has cheered for all 4 years here at Fort River High School, and has received the most improved cheerleader, MVP most outstanding player twice, captain, and the UCA jump off. And she'd like to thank Coach Val. Favorite memory here at Fort, she says, with Florida State. And advice for future cheerleaders, Emma says, work the hardest and make these memories last because high school goes by too fast. Her plans after high school are to attend Portland State University to further her education in the medical field. And she will be cheering for Portland State University. Thoughts on Emma from Coach? Coach says, thank you for being here, and your friend. I'm so proud of you and how you've become. We love you, Emma. Ladies and gentlemen, Emma Holbert. Ladies and gentlemen, our final seniors are Ross Hendricks. Our Ross is being escorted by Kiki and Sam, and Ross has cheered for all 4 years here at Carpenter High School, and has received the best sportsmanship, captain, most valuable player. And Ross would like to thank the homeless man in the Taco Bell parking lot and tell them, you'll be good. Favorite memory here at Carpenter High School, Ross says, getting nerve damage in my calf at competition practice. And advice for future cheerleaders, Ross says, don't get kicked in the face by your fire. Plans after high school, Ross says, earning a bachelor's degree at Central Washington University. And Ross will be cheerleading for Central Washington University. Thoughts on Ross and coach? Coach says, thank you, Ross, for being such an amazing athlete and a leader for your team. We love you. Ladies and gentlemen, the last minutes. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, your fourth seniors.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Fort Vancouver High School for tonight's 2A Greater St. Helens League boys basketball matchup between the visitors from Hudson's Bay High School and the home team, the Fort Vancouver Trappers. We got an interesting game tonight. My name is Owen Frazier. My broadcast partner tonight is Coach Ty Stanley. We got two teams that we're looking at battling for playoff spots. The 2A Greater St. Helens League has 9 teams. And so the top 6 will make it to the league playoffs, with the top 2 teams in the league getting byes, and the top 2 teams from the league tournament making it up to the district tournament, where they'll play against a couple teams from the EVCO league. So it should be a really good matchup tonight. Hudson's Bay coming into the game 2-5 in league play, 3-6 overall. They currently sit in 6th place, and then Fort Vancouver 1-4 in league, 4-5 overall. A lot to talk about with this standings and the breakdown, but with Hudson's Bay has 2 games to play this week. Fort Vancouver has 3. Hawkinson also has 1 win. Woodland also has 1 win. So this is crazy looking at the standings of where we're at right now and what this last week could mean for everybody.
Yeah, with just a couple games left, you can see there's a little bit of a log jam in the middle of the pack there fighting for these 6 playoff seeds. And you know, a game like tonight is going to go a long way. These guys are going to get amped up for a little rivalry game, but also trying to fight for a playoff spot. So I think there's a little extra motivation here if these players need one. I know when it's Trappers Eagles, there's some extra edge there, and so they're ready to go and try and find a way to get into that 6th playoff seed.
Yeah, both of these teams, you know, like you mentioned, this is always a big game, but when you've got the playoffs on the line, it makes it even bigger. For Hudson's Bay, if they win tonight, they would almost lock up one of the final playoff spots because they will only have one more game, and it's against Woodland, who right now is the bottom team in the league. So you would think that they'd have a really good shot to get themselves in. Fort Vancouver has Hudson's Bay tonight, then they go to play Woodland, and then Columbia River, who's good, not great. So they've got a chance to finish strong this last week. And the question on everybody's mind is going to be, will Khalil Singleton be playing? We saw him warm up. He has not played since the very first game of the year. He dropped 38 points. Fort Vancouver won a non-league game against undefeated R.A. Long. So they showed what they could do with him in the lineup. And then since Khalil went out, they've went 3-5 without him. And so we saw him warm up. And obviously, he's not going to start tonight. But whether or not he plays is going to have a huge role in how this game goes.
Yeah, I think long term, I mean, obviously Khalil wants to be out there and his teammates want to be out there. Long term, you got to look out for his health as well. But, you know, that's a lot of firepower sitting on the bench, and we'll see how many minutes he goes for tonight and see what his numbers look like. More importantly, see how his injury holds up.
Yeah, that's the question that he's going to want to know. Fort Vancouver taking some time to honor a couple of their former players who have since passed away in the last couple years. So we'll take a second to honor that moment of silence. But, yeah, back to Khalil, like you said, he's in a tough spot. I mean, there's not a high school kid out there that wouldn't want to be on the court with their friends, especially where they're at and the importance of tonight's game. But like you said, he's got much bigger things ahead. He's only a junior, the last thing you'd want to do, and especially with something as weird as what he's dealing with the stress fracture. You know, he was in a boot for a little while, but it's just those things are so hard, and he has just got cleared today to be able to play, and so you wonder about, you know, his conditioning and all that kind of stuff. So either way, we're expecting to see a great game. Both of these teams are solid teams with or without him, but it's tough to talk about previewing this game tonight without going over that big question.
Yeah, and you've seen some big numbers from guys step up with filling in for Khalil with Keontae Cage and Trey Cannon and those guys putting up some big numbers as we get going here in the first quarter.
Yeah, I mean, that's been, you know, the nice thing for Fort Vancouver is for some of these guys, they were just kind of like, you know, watching Khalil do his thing a little bit, and then now all of a sudden they've moved into starring roles. Trey Cannon had 35 points in the game the other night. He has been phenomenal this year because prior to that, he'd kind of been a role player. Gabe Daigle had kind of been a role player. Keontae Cage had kind of been a role player, and then Khalil goes out, and those guys knew they had to step up, and they did. I mean, they won the first 3 games without him, 3 of the first 4 games without him, and so they showed that they can win without him. That has not been a question.
Early foul puts Eagles on the line for 1 out of 2.
Hudson's Bay is going to press a little bit out of the 3-quarter court, create some turnovers. We talked about turnovers were the stat of the game in the first matchup between these two teams.
Brett, the number said 50 turnovers between the two teams last game. That's you know, that's a game in the mud right there. And you know, hopefully, I know both coaches are probably looking for a little cleaner effort.
Well, we're going to get our answer right away. Khalil Singleton has stepped up to the scorers table, so they are not wasting any time getting him into this game. But, yeah, looking at the last game, it was a non-league game. It was the third game of the year. Nope, like only five practices before the first game this year. So there were a lot of growing pains for a lot of people early on in the season. So, you know, the big question and the big thing that both coaches mentioned was we got to take care of the ball better tonight. That was both coaching staffs talking about that. So, right, but then we saw Fort Vancouver turn one over early. That's what Hudson's Bay does. Coach Will Jones I've known for a long time, and that's been a staple of his team when he was a head girls coach and a head boys coach, is they're going to press, they're going to pressure you, they're going to try and force you into mistakes.
And I think with a couple of dominant scores with Trey and Khalil, you want to make sure that you're applying pressure elsewhere, get the ball out of their hands early, and take your chances with the rest of the squad.
Yeah, Coach Jones did mention that they prepared for both Khalil playing and not playing. Again, Khalil hasn't played in nine games. And so they kind of prepared for both. And so it'll be interesting to see which, you know, how they adjust to the fact that he's in there now. But like you mentioned, when you can pressure like that, it'll create some different problems.
Yeah, and I think we'll get a good look at how Khalil's feeling with that ankle, on how aggressive he is. He went down on that first possession and came up short with an air ball and a little floater in the lane. But, you know, if he stays aggressive, I think he's probably feeling good, and that's probably back to his ball game there.
Yeah, I think these first few minutes are going to be really key for him and for both teams to just kind of see how this plays out a little bit. So Fort Vancouver has a better job of breaking the pressure this time. They'll get into their offense. They run a five out, open middle. They get Khalil there loose for a three. I can guarantee you that is not what Hudson's Bay had planned, for him to get a look that clean.
Right.
I don't care if he's hurt or dead, Khalil, or sleeping, Khalil makes that shot 90% of the time, that open.
Hudson's Bay tries to answer with the missed three. Good offensive rebound there. Yeah, and Hudson's Bay opened up in a zone defense there. It'll be interesting to see if, you know, the three ball pulls them out of that, or if they just try and manage it with the zone. But, you know, with two guys, with Trey and Khalil, and guys getting to the hoop, you're not sure if it's pick your poison, really. Open up three-point line in the zone, or maybe allow dribble penetration man-to-man.
And they play traditionally a lot of zone. I mean, they've rarely played man this year. They play a lot of 2-3, a lot of 3-2. They mix that up to be able to, you know, kind of show some different looks, because Coach Jones has never really been a man guy, as long as I've known him. Coach Jones has been around forever. He was an assistant coach at Hudson's Bay in 2000 when I first showed up as a freshman boys basketball player. So he's been around a long time.
Khalil,
just Khalil again.
One, yeah. Good look there. Finding Khalil in the center of the key.
But Coach Jones took over this job. He was the head girls coach for a while. He was an assistant with the boys program, now taking over as a head coach. You know, somebody that I really respect, that I've got a great relationship with. And he's done a really good job in this first year. They're playing a couple sophomores, guys that played C-Squad as freshmen last year. So they're pretty young and inexperienced still, but he's done a really good job with this team. Khalil's going to go to the line now. And he shoots about 88, 90% from the foul line. He's going to make those. Fort Vancouver, a little pressure of their own now. Baseline driving, a good swing, gets them a good look.
Good ball moving there. Three-pointer for Hudson's Bay. Number two, that's Brendan Williams.
Yeah, that's the first few. They got a few good looks from three, and that's the first one they were able to knock down. They looked just a little bit excited early and threw a couple just too hard off the glass. But
good rebound putback there.
Yeah, Cadena with the putback. Good take from Trey. And that's some of the things that dribble penetration will open up for your team, right? Not just you getting the basket, but then guys come over to help, and that allows for you to get putbacks. Another good look from three, but just rattles out. Fort Vancouver will take it down. Up two. Good pace here now. We're getting into it a little bit better. Khalil gets a good look.
Just comes up short. Cadena with another tip-out rebound. Good attack there in the foul. Oh, they're going to go travel.
Travel. Yeah, I think the travel was the right call on Daigle right there. Fort Vancouver's now going to apply a little bit of full court pressure of their own. Little 1-2-2. Yeah, one of the old adages is sometimes the teams that press don't necessarily like to be pressed.
Right.
So it'll be interesting to see Bay, who's known for their pressure, how they handle that pressure.
And that's the thing right there as a coach that you get frustrated with. You know, you want your kids playing high intensity and trapping the ball and hustling to the ball, but those fouls, you know, 35, 40 feet away from the hoop, those will kill you at the end of the half, end of the game.
And Fort Vancouver, I mean, they do. Without Khalil, they were playing six players. With him, they'll play maybe play seven. So guys getting in foul trouble really, really hurts them. And they've had some times this year where they've had some of their key guys with three, four fouls early in games and had to adjust. And so they don't want, like you said, pick up those cheapies out there away from the basket. Hudson's Bay really active in their zone. They're doing a nice job of yeah, like you said, being active and using their hands. And they've made it tough on Fort Vancouver so far. Their zone has been really good.
Good look inside.
Nice high-low action. Kadena got away with it. He kind of looked like he hesitated a little bit, didn't think he was going to be that open, and then ended up having more time than he thought, but converted the two right there. Nice job.
You know, textbook zone beater right there. Find the guy at the elbow, drop it down to the block, and one dribbling in.
Good aggressive take right there and gets the roll. Hudson's Bay cuts it to 10-8. Nice job there. That's number 23. That's Isaiah David. He's probably one of their top two guys to see Cannon get to the glass easy. But David's probably their number two scorer. Joey Gordon has been kind of the leader offensively for Hudson's Bay throughout this year. But David's had some really good games as well.
Another three ball for Hudson's Bay. Khalil pushing up the floor. We'll see how they handle this zone again here next time down.
Khalil with the pull up. Two, long two. I think those are the shots I guess you'd prefer him to take. A long two off the bounce, but when he gets that shot off, it just every shot looks like it's going in.
Yeah, there's something when a guy can score, there's something special about just watching the release, and it's, you know, something different with scores in basketball. It's similar to, you know, guys that can hit in baseball. It just sounds different off the bat. With with Khalil, you just expect every shot. It doesn't matter where he's going to pull up from or take it to. It's, you expect it to go in.
And his release just makes it so easy. You know, it's why he's so consistent, because his release is so consistent. A good look from David. David knocks down the three. 14-11 now.
He's going punch for punch. Yeah, 14-11. We got 3 minutes to go in the first.
Cannon's going to go pull up himself. Long rebound to Crawford. And the Trappers are going to reset. Khalil rocks the cradle.
3-1.
And that's the thing that makes him so deadly. It's not just that he can, you know, catch and shoot. He can shoot it off the bounce. He's quick enough now that he can create that separation. Again, if you're Hudson's Bay, you never want him to get a shot off. But if that's the one that he's going to hit, and it's contested, but you certainly don't want to foul him too. Certainly doesn't look like there's any rust on him.
and he doesn't need his confidence boosted. He comes in confident with every shot. He thinks he can make every shot in the gym, and that's to his credit, the work that he's put in. But, you know, he's going to start feeling it. Here he goes with a heat check. Just off the iron.
Cannon with a catch and shoot three. And just like that, Fort Vancouver extends the lead up to 21-11. Cannon's a capable shooter. He's been known for just getting to the basket, but he knocks down enough shots to keep you honest. And then there's another answer.
Number three, Eddie Greer.
Yeah, Greer's a 5'9 junior. He's knocked it down. So Hudson's Bay shooting the ball well, too. It's going to be defensively for them, because offensively, Fort's gotten just about everything that they could want. They've gotten some open looks from three, and then also a couple dunk downs underneath, and have gotten some layups as well. So offensively, Fort has done a really good job here.
Yeah, the
early.
Eagles look a little bit slow on the rotations in that zone, and Fort's been able to get some good looks underneath on the weak side of that zone.
Another look for David for three, and he knocks it down. Have yourself a quarter, young man. Talking about Khalil, Isaiah David comes out. He's hit three threes now here in this first quarter. We got a high-scoring quarter, 23-17. But Singleton gets another look, fouled again, and scores. Wow.
They can just call it a tease as well.
That's – oh, who did they call it on?
It looks like it's a double –
Yeah, we're trying to see, get this cleared up.
Looks like it's a common foul on the three on number 10, Joey Gordon. And then perhaps it got Khalil for a little bit of a taunt.
Yeah, and that was interesting because the official that called the tee was on the exact opposite part of the court. Gordon kind of stood over Khalil after Khalil made the shot, and Khalil did not like that, kind of got up and talked back to him, and then the official came over. I don't know if I love that tee right there. I mean, this is high school basketball. We want everybody to be a good sport and all that, but, I mean, that's a pretty big shot, heat of the moment, and I think maybe you can give warnings right there and hopefully make sure that that doesn't happen because – I mean, that's a big call early in the game.
Yeah, and you just wonder, too, there's been so much talk in the NBA lately about nice guys because they've all grown up together playing at AAU, and you just wonder how much Khalil and Joey and some of these guys on these two teams know each other just from being around the circuit. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not so much of a intimidation or taunt thing. It's just, a gamesmanship and competitive edge. But, you know, a referee thought it went a little too far there, and, you know, you can't fault him, I guess, to keep this game in check early on.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you make a great point, though, about, you know, guys kind of coming up together and you know, you're not getting in anybody's face or anything like that. I think that's a little different. Still from Cannon. He does a nice job of finishing around the basket. You know, he's only 5'7".
A lazy turnover there from the Eagles. No pressure in the backcourt, just the mental errors there. Now, the Eagles started out, they wanted to be kind of more aggressive on defense, but the momentum has changed, and the Trappers have been pesky, and I think, their pressure has been bothering the Eagles on their trips down offensively.
It'll be interesting now that Singleton's out to see how Hudson's Bay reacts and see, honestly, how Fort Vancouver reacts. Got away with the travel right there. To see how Fort Vancouver reacts because Singleton had a huge first quarter coming off the bench. And they've played without him, but this is the first time they're playing without him after kind of having him for a quarter.
Yeah. You know, whether or not that was a planned exit, you know, it's probably a good rest for him. Catch the quarter break in an extra minute.
Yeah, I'm assuming it was pretty well calculated from Coach Enzi that he probably had that ready, and he had a plan of when Khalil was going to get in and get out. And I think Trappers might have gotten away with a foul right there. His pace has picked up for sure.
24 seconds left in the first quarter. Trappers up by 11. Keontae Cage with three. Comes up empty, but a good hands play there.
Stolen away from Gabe Daigle. Daigle's one of those guys who stepped up with Singleton's absence and then another turnover. The turnovers were, we said, the key to the first game. It was a low-scoring first game. The first game between the two teams was 52-44. We might pass that at the half tonight.
Trappers at 31 in the first quarter for a high school basketball game.
And we're not keeping stats up here, so we're not exactly sure about who's got what or how many.
And I'd say that's pretty efficient, 31 points, too. I mean, it hasn't been a lot of missed shots, but they're pushing the pace, and they're mixing it in inside, outside, and taking care of business at the stripe as well.
Yeah, I don't know what Hudson's Bay needs to do defensively. I mean, obviously, when Singleton's in the game, you're going to have to make sure that you're shadowing him a little better than they have. I don't think that they can guard Fort Vancouver man-to-man, to be completely honest. I mean, the way that Fort's been able to get to the basket off the bounce in a zone, to think that they're going to be able to guard them, and when that's not really your thing, and obviously you're going to hope that Fort Vancouver's not going to continue to shoot the ball as well as they have, but really.
Yeah, it's tough when Khalil can stretch the floor so well, and then you have someone like Trey that can get to the hoop in about three steps or less and just a flash by you. I mean, full court heave from David.
Wow.
No go.
I don't think we're going to have trouble keeping the audience tonight. That first quarter was fast-paced, some really good play, some good shooting, a little bit of everything there. For Hudson's Bay, obviously, they're going to need to regroup. I think offensively, they're probably happy with the quarter that they played. If you would have told Coach Jones you'd have 18 points at the end of the first quarter after only having 44 the last game you played, you'd think he would be happy with where they're at.
Yeah, they were able to respond and take some punches and then punch back with some three balls of their own. But, you know, it kind of changed a little bit, a couple of careless turnovers and then back-to-back threes. You know, down the stretch there for the Trappers, and it puts them up big, 14 at the end of the first quarter.
Yeah, in the first matchup between these two teams, Fort Vancouver got out to an 18-9 lead at the end of the first quarter and hung on and ended up winning by eight. And so this is kind of the same thing playing out tonight, where they get that early lead and that early momentum. And, you know, there's a decent crowd in here tonight for with the COVID restrictions and everything. So you build that up on your home court, and you got to feel like you're feeling good going into the second quarter.
It'd be Trapper's ball coming out here at the second quarter.
Singleton is back in for Fort Vancouver. Hudson's Bay still in their little zone. They go low to high there for the first time. I was going to say, I think it's
wing.
Going up.
Goes off the iron, rebound to Bay. They're going to take their time coming up the floor here.
Good look at the corner three. They've had good ball movement. They get another look at another three. Just off, but a rebound kicks to Fort Vancouver. Singleton's going to go 1-on-4. Makes the right decision to pull it out here. What
good,
a good
find
pass.
There. And a good run by Dean down the lane there, too, just being patient and understanding that, you know, to always be ready when Khalil, Trey, those guys have the ball, you know, they can, they're definitely just as good at passers as they are scorers.
Yeah, nice job of making that find right there. David coming back the other way. Another good look for Hudson Bay. Knock it down. Again, their offensively has not been the issue for them. They're going to need to string together some stops, though, if they want to stay in this game. Because I don't know if they can continue to score at the pace that Fort Vancouver can.
Yeah, they're going to need to do a little bit of both. Contest the threes, but also find a way to, you know, make it tough at the rim. And I think Fort, I don't know the statistics, but just right there, Fort's come up with a lot of second chance points in that first quarter. They come up short on that, but they did have two opportunities there.
Yeah, and that's one of the difficulties in a zone. You have to be able to find people to box out. You know, in a man-to-man, you're like, you know, most of the time you're just going to end up, oh, where's my guy? Go box him out. In the zone, it's a lot more difficult.
Open
good extra pass
the
there from Singleton.
And another second chance opportunity. Good dump down.
Yeah, when a team like Fort Vancouver shooting at the clip that they are, which is maybe 50% probably so far, and then they're going to, if they're rebounding half their misses, you look at all the, you know, extra possessions and how that's going to play out for them. That's so huge.
Yeah, and at the other end, you know, Hudson's Bay's been either make the shot or one and done. They haven't been able to crash the boards offensively as much as the Trappers have, so. I think that'll be a big stat for both coaches at the end of the game to see where that ends up.
So it's just under 6 minutes here. Fort Vancouver extend their lead up to 15. Another three for Hudson's Bay. Another one goes down.
Anthony Garces Armstrong, 5'10 sophomore for the Eagles.
Yeah, like I said, Coach Jones raved about his sophomores, talked about how well they've been playing and how hard, and that jump. Cannon
answer.
Response. Nice job from Cannon. And then now
Good take.
Another good take, yeah. Ooh, they're going to get the late foul. I think it's the right call, though. Both teams play, you know, a pretty wide open offense, do a good job of driving and kicking, swinging the ball, making the extra pass offensively when there hasn't been turnovers. This has been a really clean game, really fun to watch.
And you can tell that right here shooting the free throws, Isaiah David, that he's one of the two seniors on the Eagles. Of the guys out there, he looks calm, he's handling the ball, he's knocked down some shots, he's taken to the rim. You can tell he's got some experience, and you know, he's done a good job this first couple quarters.
Yeah, Williams and David, the two seniors for Hudson's Bay that get the most minutes. Fort Vancouver, you know, they're four of their top six are seniors, and so that's kind of been, you know, where they've been able to have some success this year is they've got a lot of experience. Cannon played varsity as a sophomore. Keontae Cage played varsity as a sophomore, so they've got a lot of experience, and there's just something about by the time you get to your senior year, just kind of that moxie that comes with it a little bit. And even if someone, you know, might have been a JV player as a junior, there's just something about being a senior that just makes you feel like you belong.
And beyond that, I mean, everything just slows down. You get that one extra year of playing. You get the confidence of, you know, being in a program for potentially 4 years, and another three ball there for the Eagles, and they're chipping away back into it with down by 10.
So Fort Vancouver will reset. Do a nice job of just, I really like the ball screen against the zone. I feel like not as many teams use it. It's just a really simple way to kind of create some separation and create some opportunities. And they've done a nice job with that to get them some looks here. But that time, Hudson Bay does a good job of boxing out there and getting the foul. And now, you know, the fouls are going to play a role into the rest of this game. Both teams will be in the bonus for the last 4 minutes of this half.
And that was a clean look for Khalil. Just came up a little short, but a good screen out there from Crawford to open up the lane for Khalil.
And that's Crawford. That's what he does for this team. Just literally all of the little things. He's a great screener, great passer, great defender. You know, they put him at the high and the low and try and get him, you know, some opportunities to just kind of create havoc offensively with his, you know, he's one of the best tennis players in our area. Didn't play basketball last year, didn't play as a sophomore, and came back out this year and has been a huge part of the success of this team. Lead is down to 8 now. Hudson's base cut it to 39-31, just over 4 minutes to go here in the second quarter. Cannon with a pull-up 2.
We'll have to see next time down. It looked like that was a little zone with a man on Khalil, so a little bit of a...
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me to see them go to a little box and one action. Another open 3.
With the amount of threes that Hudson's Bay has been taking, it's, you know, I'm curious if that was the game plan from Coach Will Jones going in, looking at film, or if that's a game plan from Ensley to, you know, see what their percentage is from three and dare them into those three balls, and, you know, you live and die by it. And so far, the Eagles have... They've kept up their end of the bargain, keeping it within 10 and knocking down some big threes. But, you know, there's been a lot of threes that have gone up in this game so far in the first quarter and a half.
Yeah, Fort Vancouver has been really, really good defensively this year. Coach Ensley, to his credit, kind of gave over the reins of the defense to assistant coach James Jones, who's a Trapper alum, someone that I coached, who was one of my favorite kids I've ever had, just played incredibly hard, ended up playing some college basketball. And this year, Coach Ensley just said, look, I need to give up some responsibility. I want you to take the defense. Coach Jones has done a phenomenal job. They've played several games in the 40s this year and really held down some teams. And they're, you know, defensively limited because they just don't have very much size. But they play so hard, and usually schematically, they've got a good plan. But today, I mean, Hudson's Bay is really non-traditional in their offense as well because they play that five-guard open middle type, and then they're able to kind of create a lot of opportunities for themselves. So both teams doing really well here.
Yeah,
there's another good look.
It's definitely, you know, it's a game of guards here tonight. I don't think there's a guy out there that's playing that's, you know, 6'3 is the tallest. We've got a couple guys listed as 6'3, and
they're certainly not 6'3.
Sure. That's the high school roster right there.
Oh, absolutely.
Khalil empty from the wing there on the three ball, and another rebound for the Eagles. Long rebound, kick back out. David at the top.
David's just a crafty player. He just makes so many really good plays. Wasn't able to finish that one right there, but I've been really impressed with his game tonight.
Cannon attacks and gets the foul call. Ball doesn't drop, so he'll have two at the line.
Yeah, Cannon's just really, really tough to guard. He is as quick. I was trying to think back. You know, I've been involved with the Fort Vancouver basketball program for a long time, for the last 15 years or whatever. I was trying to think if there's been a guard with as much quickness as he's got. And he's one of those. I was asking Coach Jones about, you know, some of the Fort players, and he's like, he's one of the kids over the last 8 months of COVID that didn't take it for granted, that didn't just go, you know what, I'm going to go to the river, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. He's like, he's been working on his game, and you can tell. He's stronger, he's more athletic, but he's a much better player than he was last year. And I've been really impressed with the season that he's had. He deserves it. Fort Vancouver really turning up the pressure right now, but can they get back and get out on shooters?
Good hustle play there.
And just can't wait to get up the next three.
Trapper's out on the run. And that's easy doing right there for 32. Leads and back up to 11.
That's where his game has really developed, Khalil's, in the last couple years. I mean, his body, I'm sure you were his eighth grade coach. I'm sure you remember what he looked like as an eighth grader. I feel like I've seen some pictures, and he was maybe 100 pounds at least he looked like in some of the stuff. He was really small. He's developed his body and become a much better player because he's just gotten physically stronger.
Yeah, and you know, grew a couple inches, put on a few pounds, but even so, as an eighth grader, you know, you could just tell his body control was phenomenal, even getting in the lane, and you could tell he's played against older guys and, you know, could do the little hang and bump and still finish. And then, you know, of course, he's deadly from the outside, so he's, you know, worked on some of those skills with the hesitation, a crossover, and pull-up jumper. And he's really, you know, he's got a lot of tools in his bag, and, you know, I think he's trying to make the most of it here his last season as a Trapper.
Yeah, I think for him, you know, he's certainly not the most overly athletic and gifted kid, right? I mean, he's a kid that's a product of, I mean, sure, he was gifted. He's talented. But he's a kid that's a product of a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
And like you said, his ability to, look at that bounce.
Wow.
His ability to control his body and be crafty and all that is so important as he's developed his game. He's got to be careful right now, though.
He's got one tee already.
I don't know what he was complaining about.
So the three goes in for the Eagles. Cuts to an 8-point game, and number two, Brandon Williams, looking to convert the 4-point play, and he does.
Yeah, I don't remember the last game that I saw 3 4-point plays in one half in.
Right.
Because we've had three of those tonight already. Yeah, they've done a better job of keeping Khalil from getting a good look here in the second quarter. And again, those are the plays that Sam Crawford makes.
Offensive,
you know,
rebound, good look inside, and draws the foul. And you'll have to fill me in, someone who's watched some Trapper basketball, Gabe Daigle. He's had some open looks in the corner, and it looks like it's part of the offense. He's just coming up a little off tonight, so.
Yeah, he's had some good games. You know, he had 21 in a game the other night, and the pace of the game might just be a little fast tonight or whatever, but he's certainly a more capable player than he's shown right now. He hasn't had the type of games that he's having, but hopefully he'll find his rhythm because he's had some good looks.
We're going to go offensive foul. Good hustle play there by Dean Cadena.
Yeah, Cadena's a kid that's really, got into this role of trying to take charges, and that's something that, you know, Coach Jones, who's, I guess you could call, like, a defensive coordinator, really preaches within their guys, and they take a lot of pride in taking charges, and he stepped up right here. We get a look at the replay. He got over there maybe a little late, but got the call.
I've been so into the game, I haven't even looked at the monitor to take a look at instant replays tonight.
Good pass there from Daigle. Crawford just can't get it to fall.
Crawford picking him up full court.
Yeah,
And you can just tell the court's just, there's not a lot of room to move with the ball if you're an Eagle right now. They're getting some open looks, but.
Yeah, that's a really good call by the official right there. Yeah, it's like I've at times felt like Fort was dominating this game, and then now you look up and it's a 7-point game, and the way both teams have been shooting tonight, that's the score's gonna can flip in a heartbeat here.
That's a good look there. Third opportunity, and Trappers.
Eventually Singleton ends up with it. Hudson's base gonna have to go here, 6 seconds.
Deep three, comes up short.
Oh, if he hits that one, I walk out. Wow, what a first half.
47 at the half, and like you said, I wouldn't have been surprised to look up and see the Trappers up by 15 or 20 at this point, but you look up and, it's a 9-point lead, and the Eagles, they have to be feeling pretty good about themselves going into halftime with 37 points on the board and down 9 and, weathering a few punches and also delivering them right back from the 3-point line.
Yeah, we're taking a look at the highlights right now, and it's a lot of threes going down. Obviously, Singleton had a big half, but Hudson's Bay shot the ball really well. Several different guys were able to knock down threes, and so we'll get to the halftime show. Stick around for that. We'll be back in about 9 minutes and 30 seconds.
Hello, everybody. Today we are at Hudson's Bay High School, checking out one of the most honorable seniors here, Annabelle, and looking at her achievements.
Annabelle Petty has been balancing the workload of high school, running start, and her passion for basketball, a sport she has been playing for about 10 years.
I got into basketball because there was a league starting up at my school and some of my friends joined it, so I joined it kind of on a whim just to play with them, and then I just fell into the sport from there.
In addition to this, Annabelle placed within the top 5% in her class for her stellar grades.
I know academically she excels really well, but specifically for basketball, she's always got a great positive attitude, and she's the first one willing to help any of the younger girls out or less skilled.
With all of these commitments on her plate, staying organized is one of her most valuable tools.
I try to stay on top of everything as best as I can, and really when it comes down to those decisions of if I'm going to just lay around or hang out or get some extra shots in or do the work, I do that.
After high school, Annabelle plans to attend WSU Vancouver and participate in their teaching program.
Once I'm a little bit older, I definitely plan on coaching. I think that's going to be a great combination of my passion in education and teaching and my passion with this game as well. I definitely don't want to leave it anytime soon.
I wish I had a little bit more time with her. Only 4 years is kind of short, but overall, she's been an amazing asset to the team. So whichever field she chooses, I think she'll be a light for people.
Wait to see what Annabelle continues pursuing in her future. Thank you so much for tuning into the story with us. My name is Isis Eggleston, and we will see you all next time.
Hi, everybody. Time for a quick look inside Vancouver Public Schools. I'm Nick Bohl. A special event at Ogden Elementary brought families on campus for a reading adventure. The Story Walk, which runs for 10 days, let parents and kids come to school to read a story about saying thanks to the people who help you. The book's pages were divided into different stations so families could read as they walked around the school.
I enjoyed reading and walking around. It's like a puzzle, and I like puzzles.
Trips to school are rare for Via, who is in full-time remote learning.
So it's nice to get her on campus and interactively learning.
Stations included options for non-English speakers.
¿A quién olvidé darle las gracias?
У меня есть много кого благодарить. Мне нужно начать это делать.
There were also fun activities like this chalk writing area to thank someone who deserves it. With COVID, school staff had to rethink how they do family engagement events, which are important at Ogden.
And this year it was just hard to kind of get our heads wrapped around it with not congregating large crowds of people. So this was perfect we could do something where families could participate. It was at the school, and then adding reading and outside was bonus.
Remote learning hasn't been easy, but Via's mom is pleased with how it's gone.
So far, everyone has been fantastic. I feel like even though she's 100% remote, I don't feel like she has been behind in her education at all. I feel like all the teachers, all of them, from like her classroom teacher to the librarian to the PE teachers, all of them have been just very good at communicating and very invested in her education.
The event at Ogden runs through Tuesday morning, so if you're in the neighborhood, check it out. Thanks for watching. I'm Nick Vole. Hi, everybody. Time for a quick look inside Vancouver Public Schools. I'm Nick Vole. The school district is driving its way into the future with three new electric school buses. We got to take a ride along on the first morning of operation. Jim Ziegler has been driving buses for a while, but this is his first official spin in one of the school district's new electric buses.
First thing I was surprised by was how powerful it is. I thought maybe an electric engine wouldn't really suffice for a 18,000-pound vehicle, but it's surprisingly more peppy than a regular diesel bus. And it's also very smooth and very quiet. It's very comfortable to drive.
Vancouver Public Schools applied for a grant through the state to purchase the buses, which made them cheaper than buying new diesel models.
About a $13,000 savings up front, plus all of the fuel savings that we'll be able to achieve throughout the life cycle of this bus.
Jim appreciates the switch away from diesel fuel.
It's way easier to fuel the diesel bus. We have to drive over to a pump and weasel up right next to it, the very large vehicle, and stand there for a long time as it fills with diesel and try not to spill it on the ground, which can also be an environmental hazard. And this just plugs in like an appliance.
The environmental impact goes beyond spilled fuel.
And driving around the bus, you don't often get, you know, you don't smell the diesel. You don't get hit by fumes as you inspect the bus in the morning while it's running and all that kind of thing. Yeah, I think it's good for the city and good for the kids.
Which is why Senator Patty Murray is proposing a massive investment in electric buses across the country.
Transportation accounts for the largest share of greenhouse gas emissions in the United States. With approximately 500,000 school buses on the road traveling over 3 billion miles per year, it is so important that we take steps to transition to cleaner buses.
Her bill would subsidize school districts to purchase more electric buses, something Vancouver Public Schools would likely pursue.
It's really neat to be a part of the district's new step in, you know, green technology, and it's great.
The state grant the district received was part of the Volkswagen diesel emission settlement. 21 other districts around Washington also received that grant. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time, I'm Nick Vole. Hi everybody, time for a Revitalizing Vancouver update, the latest on construction projects across Vancouver Public Schools. I'm Nick Vole. The newest elementary school in town at long last has a name. The school board voted unanimously.
So we have a new Ruth Bader Ginsburg Elementary School on 25th Avenue.
The elementary school being built on Northeast 25th Avenue in Hazeldale will be named after legal pioneer Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who passed away last year after a long and celebrated legal career, culminating with a placement on the United States Supreme Court. Board member Kathy Decker cited her tireless work to fight for gender equality.
She is just a wonderful example of somebody being told pretty much her whole life, you can't do this because, and her saying, oh yes, I'm going to do it. And I think that we need to elevate those role models when we can.
Wendy Smith also lauded Ginsburg's ability to find common ground with people with whom she disagreed.
One of the things that she's also very well known for is her very, very close friendship to Justice Antonin Scalia, who could not have been more opposite her in so many different ways. And I think they might have been on opposing sides of arguments more often than not, you know. But they had a great respect for each other. They had a wonderful working relationship. They were very, very close. And I think that they're just such an excellent example of how we can have differences of opinions without being divided. And so I just think she's just such a wonderful example and a wonderful person to name a building after.
The name beat out four other finalists submitted by the public. More than 250 name ideas were suggested. The school is scheduled to open in the fall of 2022 and will serve around 400 students. Ginsburg Elementary will relieve overcrowding at nearby schools. It's one of four schools in VPS named after women, joining Sacagawea, Sarah J. Anderson, and Eleanor Roosevelt Elementaries. With the name in place, the school now needs a mascot. My personal suggestion would be the Justices, but feel free to leave your ideas in the comments section. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time, I'm Nick Bull.
All right, welcome back. Hopefully you enjoyed that 10-minute break. We are just about to start the second half of action here. Fort Vancouver leading 46-37 over Hudson's Bay. Some key takeaways in the from the first half looking back. Khalil Singleton led Fort Vancouver with 22 points. Trey Cannon added 12. Dean Cadena with 8. And then for Hudson's Bay, Isaiah David led them with 12 points. And then Brendan Williams with 11. So definitely some guys standing out there in the first half. We'll see who can kind of keep it going here in the second half. Offensively, I think both teams would like to keep going what they had. It's just going to be a matter of making some defensive adjustments to win the ball game.
And the Eagles ended the first half with 8 made threes, and they come out on the first possession, put one up for a miss. But, you know, that's a huge part of their game. That's what kept them in it in that first half, was finishing those three balls. And here comes another step back three.
And you see it on that possession right there, that 2-1-1 fast break. Instead of getting to the basket, he pops right out to the – But honestly, that's how the game is evolving right now. Like, even especially at the highest levels in the NBA, it's like it's threes and layups, and teams are shooting more threes than they ever have before, and it's all data backed now. I mean, that's professional sports everywhere right now, is just whatever the data is saying we should do is what we're kind of trying to do and find the personnel to meet it, as we see Cannon get off to a good start here in the second half.
And finish. And I would say that Khalil's ankle is feeling good. I think he came out for that short stint at the end of the first quarter, played the whole second quarter, I think. And here he is starting the second half, 22 points on the board.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, they got him in there right away. I wonder if that, you know, if they just wanted to mess with him a little bit, or if, you know, they just, for whatever, they didn't want to have him start just because of this. I don't know what it is. I'll be interested to talk to Coach Ensley afterwards.
And a good find underneath and finish there.
Kadena's been good. You know, like we said, he had 8 in the first half, and a lot of easy ones like that, which are the kinds of the buckets they say, you know, it's, they call them easy shots, but they're not easy to get. You know, getting easy shots is a really difficult thing to do, but he's found his way into several easy shots tonight.
Yeah, and you can, I mean, credit his work ethic, credit the coaches, but he finds himself in the right spot, the right place at the right time, and his eyes are up looking for the pass. And you know, if he's going to just be open for two footers all day long, I'm sure he'll be satisfied with that.
Yeah, absolutely. No, you're exactly right. He just seems to find himself in the right place all the time, and that has served him very well. And then he does, you know, he's an undersized guy, Kadena is. I mean, they list him at 6'2", but I don't think he's an inch above 6 foot. But he, you know, handles himself really well around the basket. So be Trapper ball, just over 6 minutes left here. They've extended the lead up to 13 already here early.
Yeah, Hudson's Bay is 0 for 3 or 0 for 4 on their first couple trips down the floor. You know, they played at a pretty high level in that first half, a lot of up and down. And, you know, gym's a little toasty tonight. I'm sure, you know, you can never put anything on conditioning, but still, it's, you know, I'm sure there'll be some tired legs here in the second half, and we'll see who's up for it towards the end.
Trey Cannon definitely does not seem to have tired legs right now. He does a really nice job of using the Euro step and using his body and kind of contorting himself around the basket. Like we said, he had a good first half with 12. He's got a couple early baskets here, and when you combine his ability to get to the basket with the shooting ability of Singleton and the slashing of Keontae Cage, and it makes them really difficult, really, really difficult to guard. And I think it's a good time out there from Coach Will Jones. So we're at announcement three here. We want to thank District Warehouse, Mark Novak, Roger Anderson, John LaFour, Mike Nicholson, Kathy Potter, so many people to thank. We appreciate you all.
And just a NBA playoff note, Dame Lillard with the game-tying three at the end of the fourth quarter, pushing it into overtime against the Nuggets.
I don't know how competitive we're going to be with our broadcast with that Blazer game tonight. But as soon as that thing hurries up and gets over, I'm sure people are going to pile on over to our broadcast. Oh, I don't like. That's the right call. I just don't like it when it's that late.
Mm-hmm.
It's just absolutely the right call, but it just didn't have to come that far after the play was made.
And good attack there by the Eagles. You know, making sure that they get some points here or potentially get some points and not settling for the jump shot and trying to attack the rim. I think it's going to be important for the Eagles to, you know, stay within range here moving into the fourth quarter with the scoring capability and the way the guys are shooting right now for the Trappers. If they want to have a chance in the fourth quarter, they're going to have to make some moves here at the last 5.5 in the third. Good offensive rebound. 4-on-1 rebound or 4-on-2 rebound there for the Eagles.
I guarantee you that play will get covered in a film session very, very soon. And we saw Fort Vancouver dominate on the offensive glass in the first half, and then now here in the second half, Hudson's Bay's done a nice job of getting themselves some second chance points.
And that was number 40, Isaac Finn, 6'4 sophomore for the Eagles with a couple offensive boards.
Yeah, he's good. When I first watched the first game that these two teams played, he was one of the first kids that I was like, who's that? Who's that body? Because, yeah, they, like you said, they list him at 6'4", and he's certainly big physical kid down there. He didn't play a ton in the first half.
No.
You know, he came at the end because he started the game, and then they got him out early. And then, you know, he didn't come back until late, so I was curious what was going on with that. He wasn't in foul trouble.
A good shot off the glass. Isaiah David pours it in. That's their first buckets of the second half there for the Eagles.
That was a crafty little move from him. He had that little step off the one foot and use the glass. Those are exactly the kind of plays that I would guess that he's going to make based on what I've seen from him so far. This one's going up.
Good closeout there from the backside of the zone by number two for the Eagles, and it goes off for Khalil. Eagles try to respond here. And that was empty. A lazy pass there.
All right, so Hudson's Bay has a chance to cut it to possibly 10 here right now on this possession. Wouldn't be crazy to think that they're going to hit a three with all that they've taken so far. Fort continuing to pressure in the man, and then a turnover. Fort's going to have a 3-on-2 break.
Finishes it up. Khalil Singleton, another bucket. Transition.
Quickly, the Eagles come back the other way.
Yeah, if I'm the Eagles, I'm looking for number 23.
There, Kadena. Nice job. That's a man rebound right there with big number 40 coming over his back and did a nice job. There's a good feed, good look, good cut. Ball gets knocked away.
That was definitely tipped there, but they're going to call it Eagle ball.
Yeah, that one was definitely missed there by the official. Manny Miniweather checks into the game for Hudson's Bay. He had 3 fouls in the first half, so it'll be important for him to keep from picking up the fourth one early on here. We do 5 fouls here at the high school level. We'll get you out of the game.
The Trappers pick up full court here, up by 15.
The result is still the same, and that's a Hudson's Bay 3.
Good offensive rebound.
There's David again. Gets the glass, just couldn't finish. Fort Vancouver coming the other way.
Eagles dropped in their 2-3 zone. Took them a while to get set. I'm surprised that the Trappers didn't recognize and just attack, but patient, finding the gaps in the zone underneath again.
Really well done there from Crawford. You know, a lot of times those guys get that ball in that position and they panic mm-hmm. and they make the pass too quick. He gave it just a little bit more for Kadena to make just a little bit further on that cut. And that was the difference for him right there. Nice job from Crawford. There, David gets it. And yeah, it was only a matter of time. You know, he's been getting good shots and just hasn't been able to get them to fall. It's only a matter of time before he was able to get one to drop. So David's to the line shooting one. A little interesting stance here on the
Yeah, normally
free throw
you feel
David.
Like you've coached to square up on those free throws, but at this point in his career, you know, what's working's working, so.
Absolutely. So the lead's still at 14. For Fort Vancouver, we're just under 3 minutes here to go. Cannon continuing to attack.
Good kick out there from Keontae Cage and good hands by the Eagles. And number 32 is coming up with it and finishing the and one.
Yeah, just a weird play right there. Just finds its way into single. He's had a couple of those tonight. He's under the basket and ball just kind of rolls to him. And again, he's such a good scorer that when he gets those buckets, you're like, gosh dang it. How do we let him get one that's easy? In terms of shooters that you've seen, is he as good as you've seen around here and as long as you've been around?
Growing up, a good finish there by number four for the Eagles. That's Manny Miniweather over some contact. Growing up, you know, there's a couple guys that are local. They're a few years older than me. Derek Ravio, I remember going to some games watching him. Richie Fromm, some of those guys that could just fill it up. And back then, you know, when you're – you know, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, it seems like the NBA when those guys are making it rain like that. And so, but in terms of my coaching career and teaching career and being around Khalil as an eighth grader, I haven't seen anything like it just, you know, as an eighth grader. And then, you know, now he's obviously one of the top players in the region, I would say, for the Northwest. So,
yeah, without a doubt. Yeah, another offensive rebound for Hudson's Bay. That's, man, I think we talked in the first half about how they weren't getting any, and now that's at least five mm-hmm. here in this half already, and they've been able to not only get those but then convert them into points.
And a dribble off the foot underneath. Cadena was in good position to just put the ball on the deck, and it went off a foot, and turnover. Tough pass. Controlled by Gordon. He goes up with the three. That just short front rim.
But again, one black jersey and four white jerseys
for the Eagles.
And Fort's getting away with it right now because they're able to score and everything. But man, you got to feel like if they want to win this game, they're gonna. I mean, again, that was one black jersey and four white jerseys, and the black jersey got the rebound.
Yeah, there just hasn't been a lot of contact on the box outs for the Trappers here, and it's led to some second chance points. And, you know, there's really a chance for the Trappers to kind of put the game away, but that's a great answer there from Trey Cannon from three.
Yeah, Cannon's hit three tonight already. He's looked really good. He's had a good game. Yeah, I was going to say that's a foul.
Miniweather to the line here. He'll shoot two. Lost control a little bit of it.
Yeah, Miniweather, just a sophomore. He got some run last year on varsity as a freshman. Certainly a talented kid. And as he continues to improve and his work ethic and commitment, all those things improve, he's going to have a really good career with two more seasons left.
And just important for the Eagles. I mean, just looking at the roster, is the amount of playing time that some of these sophomores are getting is just going to be huge down the road. You know, even just next season as they return to the, you know, it's going to be feel like a quick turnaround with returning to, you know, the normal calendar potentially for sports season. So This run's important for some of those younger guys.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there was another offensive rebound for the Eagles, but he just got his pocket picked there on the rebound, and fortunate for the Trappers come away with it.
Yeah, I guess if you're not going to rebound it, you better steal it, because you're going to have to get it back some way. Fort Vancouver can pretty much hold for the last shot. There's just a one-second differential between the shot and game clock.
And the Eagles showing a little fight here at the end. Knocked it away from Trey Cannon. And they're going to call a jump ball there.
Yeah, I don't know what they're calling now. Okay, I think they originally said Hudson's Bay ball, but then they've checked out the scores table. Yeah. So the Trappers will have the ball back. 7 seconds remain on the shot clock. 8 seconds on the game clock. Do not expect to see this ball leave Khalil's hands.
Too long from the logo, and that's not going to count. Waved off.
No, Khalil's shot hit the rim. So the shot clock horn went off, but the game clock stayed. So I think the officials are going to get this right here, because that absolutely was the right thing. Shot clock horn went off. Yeah, and Cannon definitely got that shot off before the end of the quarter there, but we'll see what the officials do. We'll take a look at some third quarter highlights. What stood out to you?
You know, two things stood out. I mean, it's a large lead for the Trappers, but I thought the Eagles, after starting cold in the third quarter, they were able to pick up the intensity and come away with some offensive boards, some second chance points. And with the Trappers, it's really just a matter of finishing, I think. You know, they did extend the lead there, but they just felt like they had a chance to really run away with the game there, and we'll see if they can put it away here in the fourth quarter.
So they are going to count that basket. I don't know if the score was already right. It's like at the half, Fort was up 7, and I felt like they should have been up 15, and now they're up 18, and I really don't feel like it's more than 10, you know, but because I don't necessarily think they played that great there in that quarter. I mean, again, they scored the ball well. Because what was it at the half? They had
31. Eagles had 31.
Yeah, 31 at the end of the quarter, and then 46 at the half. So it's like they had another 20-point quarter right there, and they held Hudson's Bay to only 11 in that quarter. But it was just all the offensive rebounds and the extra possessions that Bay got that made it feel, because they did not shoot the ball very well that quarter for sure.
And you were right. That was the shot clock that went off, so they counted the bucket for Trey Cannon at the buzzer. But they only counted it as a 2.
Yeah, I think he was just inside the 3-point line, but a really heady play by him, you know. Everybody else had stopped, and he was the only one still playing. And
a tough shot from David, and gets the runner, the leaner, the floater, whatever you want to call it, to drop.
Yeah, I really enjoy watching him play. Really, really crafty. Does a nice job using his body. He did a nice job there of just kind of getting a little bit of space, the little bit that he needed to be able to get that shot up and in.
No continuation.
No shot. First round, Eagles.
Good job by Cannon to get that shot away.
What's the worst that can happen, right? Maybe you trick somebody, maybe they're not paying attention. And Fort Vancouver looking to run something here out of the out of bounds underneath. Somehow they find a way to get Singleton just cut into the corner. Just like that, the lead's up to 19.
We're going to get an off-the-ball foul here on a grab. Looks like they got...
That'll be Daigle's. Yeah, that'll be Daigle's fourth. Oh, no, that's his fifth. Okay. So he'll foul out tonight. I think Coach Ensley will take that. You know, what a weird way to pick up your fifth, but Daigle's playing hard, trying to do what he can, and certainly got his money's worth with his five fouls.
David just decided, I'm going to do what I can to get mine here in the last quarter and, you know, try and create a spark or a little offensive punch. but it's tough to match the output from the Trappers tonight. Good scramble and run out by the Eagles for the easy bucket by Joey Gordon, number 10.
Good pass there from Cannon down to Kadena. Gets another layup. That one just flipped out. If Hudson's Bay is going to make a run, it's going to have to be right now. I mean, I think you, ideally most coaches say you want it 10 or fewer by the time you get to 4 minutes. And then right there, they cut it to 15. Yeah, Coach Hensley does the right thing and just tells school, hey, walk it up. We don't need to be in a hurry right now. They've been able to get the shots they wanted for most of the game, so there's no reason to rush into one that you don't like right now. Nice high-low action again.
Easy bucket there.
And again, that's why it's so great to just say, all right, slow it down. We can get the look we want. Really nice job from Coach Hensley.
And a quick answer there.
Yeah, that was – they didn't even make it very tough on Miniweather right there. But same thing for Ford. I mean, they've got time on their side right now.
In and out for Khalil from the top of the key. Miniweather brings it up for the Eagles and looks to attack.
Step back. Wow. So it's 13. They're well within reach. Hudson Bay needs another stop right now.
Not a lot of movement here for the Trappers offensively.
Nice job of using your body by Kadena. Gets his own rebound. And one for Crawford. Good take from Anyweather right there, I was going to say. And so Cage might have four now as well.
I say, I mean, it's...
Oh, they're going to call it on Cannon.
If I'm the Trappers, I just keep working that high post to low post move in the against the zone. The Eagles have been slowed on that rotation, and Kadena's had some easy looks. And I know he hasn't finished them all, but, you know, if it's going to be there, let's stay with it. Important free throws here for the Eagles.
Yeah, I mean, they're well within that 10 points by 4 minutes mark, but the way the Trappers have been scoring the ball, it feels like a lot more than 13, you know, because you're going to have to string together several stops in a row, and Hudson's Bay has had a really tough time getting stops.
Second free throw for Miniweather drops on the roll.
Let's see what Fort does here.
Singleton passes up, and they look inside. Won't pass it up this time. Finishes.
Coach Hensley takes a timeout. Move the lead up to 15, 4:45 here to go. I wouldn't be surprised to see Hudson's Bay maybe go back to their three-quarter court pressure, maybe just something to, if you know nothing else, even if you're not able to get steals, just to kind of push the tempo and force Fort to try and maybe play a little bit quicker than they want to, because you're now, again, working against the clock. And with the way that, Fort's been scoring, you're going to need to find other ways to get stops. Coming up here on the broadcast schedule, we got girls basketball on Wednesday, June 2nd, and that is tomorrow, 7 p.m., Fort Vancouver versus Woodland. We saw a Fort Vancouver girls program tonight. Drop one to their rival from Hudson's Bay. Shout out to the Hudson's Bay girls basketball team. They played phenomenal. So Fort Vancouver will get a crack at Woodland coming up on Wednesday, June 2nd, tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Check us out, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, all those things.
That was good ball movement there by the Trappers. Khalil passed up a three early on. They made two or three more passes and, you know, ended up coming back to him. And that's, you know, give it up and get it back and – he made the three there at the end. That probably pushes him up over 30 points, I'm guessing, here for the game.
Yeah, and again, this is only his second. He played the first game of the year, got 38. He'll be above 30 tonight.
Good little curl action from the Eagles there on the answer from Miniweather.
Yeah, Miniweather's had a good last stretch here. He's probably got 8 or 10 points, but can he stop Khalil? Because that's been the big question. Nice job, inside out.
Backside, yeah. With 4 minutes to go, Trapper lead by 13.
Yeah, that's if it gets a quick three right here, they will have met what they needed to meet. Let's see what they try and draw up right here. They're going to get the ball in the Miniweather's hands.
Good take.
Yeah, David, they take. All right, so Hudson's Bay didn't cut it to 10, but they cut it to 11. Just under 4 minutes now. It feels like any bucket now from Fort Vancouver can really seal it, and that is a big three from Singleton. I mean, they certainly haven't allowed him to get great looks, but you feel like he's got to be the focal point, and you don't even want him to get even average looks.
Yeah, well, offensive rebound put back for the Eagles, but still, with a guy that can shoot and score like that, you have to create really difficult looks for him. I mean, just being a step late, it doesn't matter. He's able to get his shot away, and he's repeatable, which is, you know, you don't find that a lot in high school guys where their shot looks the exact same every single time. That's, you know, an art and credit to his work, but, you know, that has to be a faster rotation before it gets to 32's hands.
Yeah, and Coach Jones talked about how they prepared for both, you know, Khalil being in the game and not, but, you know, he's been out for 8 games now, so you really felt like, and even if you kind of felt like he was going to play, it's really tough to think that he's going to come out after being literally, I mean, he's shot around the last few days. He's kind of gone through some practice stuff, but he's not been in a full, nothing compared to a full game like he is right now. And to think that he was going to come out and put out 30 plus is, you know, even for someone like Khalil is crazy to think that that's what he was able to do tonight coming off of an injury that's had him out for the last several weeks.
And he just continues to attack here in the fourth. Good defense by Miniweather.
Get an over and back call now. The gym is loud. The Hudson's Bay section is right behind us. And you feel like that's, you know, one of those momentum plays. And their hope, I mean, they're, like I said, just every possession now is so key. You just offensively and defensively just cannot waste a possession.
That's an unfortunate
unlucky
bounce. That ball was down and out for Miniweather.
Wow, what a tough shot from Cannon.
Circus shot. Yeah, at some point, the Eagles are going to have to put on the full court pressure here on the made baskets.
Yeah, you feel like that might have been it right there. They had to have a bucket and be able to get into something. Singleton is
good
just
finish.
not to be denied tonight. Talk about making up for lost time, boy.
A 40-point night is what I'm guessing, probably.
Yeah. He's going to probably end up with close to 40.
And a great
after
game by number 23, though, for the Eagles. Isaiah David cashes in with another three here with 2 minutes to go.
Yeah, he's been really, really good. Good screen there for Singleton on the cut. Here comes Cannon hard downhill. Good defensive play from Miniweather. Eagles going to have a bucket and quick. Gordon corner three.
Huge.
Got it.
You're going to have to pick up the pressure here, though, with 90 seconds to go.
Yeah, we're not keeping track of timeouts and stuff like that. I don't know if Jones had any left still to use to be able to get them into something, but a lot of time being wasted off the clock right now.
An interesting shot selection there, up by 10.
That'll cut it to 8. Oh, Jones looked over at his assistant and asked, do I have a timeout? Do I have a timeout? And they told him yes, but I don't know if it was early enough, but they're going to have to get going. Fort Vancouver should not take a shot before 10 seconds.
We're going timeout, Trappers.
Yeah, those last two possessions, Fort was able to cut off maybe 40 seconds you got to expect that Hudson's Bay is going to, I mean, you're in a tough, you got to still come out and trap. I mean, even with 15 seconds, every second is so important. And Hudson's Bay's only fouled twice.
Yeah.
So it's like, even if they get down to the end and they need to foul, they're going to have to foul five more times before they're even able to put Fort Vancouver on the line.
And you just wonder, too, if it's, you know, I think you need to pick them up full court, at least just to pry the pressure. But, you know, there is something to be said with the guys that can handle the ball for Fort and lead to some quick baskets on a broken press. Those sorts of things. So, you know, it's a little bit of a catch-22 for the Eagles. You want to pick them up full court, but you also don't want some run-out baskets for the Trappers. So a minute to go. Trappers lead by 8.
Yeah, they're going to let them go.
Too easy.
Good defense right there from Cage. Yeah, Cage did a really nice job of just going straight up and not fouling. You definitely don't want to put them on the line and stop the clock here. So a really good job of just contesting that. That was a good defensive play from Keontae. Eagles going to have to get one up quick. David is ready.
Three. Still an 8-point game. 26 and a half seconds there.
And now with, you know, if you're Hudson's Bay, you can be super aggressive in your press because you're probably going to need timeouts you're going to need fouls anyway. So you can really take a risk and get out there and try and commit a foul, you know, get a steal. And if you commit a foul, whatever, you just want it to happen fast because you are out of ticks right now.
You have plenty of opportunities to go for the steal here with the fouls to give for the Eagles. So.
And on a made basket in high school basketball, the clock runs.
Right.
So it's like even, you know, if they make a shot, if you don't have a timeout to stop the clock, Fort Vancouver legitimately could, you know, waste 5 seconds without even having to inbound the ball if they needed to. So every second's going to be precious right now.
And that's where some of the inexperience probably comes in for the Eagles, is being in some of these pressure pack situations and crunch time situations where, you know, you may or may not know all the details to the game down the stretch. And you know, like you said, taking those extra couple seconds, taking the ball out of bounds on a made basket, well, the clock's running, so they want to get pushing. And, you know, it's an experience thing and a coaching thing, and so we'll see how the Eagles handle it here in the last 26 seconds. Oh. And a good job by the Trappers to get up the court.
And yeah, as long as that possession was, it still was only 6 seconds. But again, now you got to get right back in there and foul again. And right now, the beauty of it is for Hudson's Bay, it doesn't matter who you foul because nobody's going to line for 4 more fouls. So just find whoever, get a hand on them, and you can't foul away from the ball.
Got to foul.
So we're going to do that about 4 more times.
A couple seconds here or there.
Yeah, Coach Ensley, good idea here to just take some time to draw something up and make sure you've got the look that you want and be able to get the ball in bounds. You've got the timeouts. You might as well use it because, again, you're still going to have to get the ball in bounds a few more times here and hang on to it.
Yeah, the worst thing that could happen here is you know, a 5-second call or, you know, a forced pass and give the Eagles another shot at life here. But down 8 with 17, it's a long shot for the Eagles. But credit to them and, you know, playing till the clock runs out, playing to zeros. And like I said, it's, you know, it's a good experience to be in these situations and you never know what happens here down the stretch.
Yeah, so Fort Vancouver will inbound the ball again, 17.9. seconds on the clock. Yeah, like you mentioned, a 5-second call, you know, you really most want to keep from getting a, you know, a pick six basically where they steal it and go lay it in and cut it down quickly. And so even if you throw it away and throw it out of bounds and whatever, it's much better that way. That was a really good setup right there. Cannon just not and even going to mess around. Yeah, Andy took the contact.
And that'll be it. We'll probably get a desperation three here from the Eagles. And
silly foul there. I'm just going to delay the inevitable. That will give us time to talk about what's going forward. So this win for Fort Vancouver will move them to 2-4 in the league, with last place Woodland and then Columbia River, who Fort Vancouver beat by 20 early in a non-league game. So you got to feel good about Fort's position to be able to maybe even, you know, not only secure the sixth spot, but jump up even into the 5 and the 4. Hudson's Bay now drops to 2-6 with just one game remaining against Woodland. If they're able to win that, they might need a little bit of help. River might end up coming down, but River would have the tiebreaker, having beaten Hudson's Bay by just a few points early on in the year. So Hudson's Bay is going to have a little bit of an uphill battle. They would have the tiebreaker over Washougal, though, should Washougal end up losing to R.A. Long and Richfield, which is very, very possible, with those being two of the top teams in the league. So a whole lot still to play. I mean, a huge win for Fort Vancouver, a win that they really needed to have. For Hudson's Bay, they're still season still in front of them. They might need a little help in some places and some things to go their way. But
And I tell you what, if you are any of the top five teams and you read the box score and see Khalil Singleton with 42, 44, whatever it ended up with, you know, there's probably some game planning that's going to be happening with some of those top schools as we enter the 16 playoff tournament, because, you know, between Khalil and a couple of the role players on the Trappers team, it's a dangerous team putting up 85. There's not a lot of teams in the league that are going to be able to compete with 85.
And how unfair is that if they slide into the sixth seed?
Right.
You know, it's like, wait a minute. This is the team that potentially, you know, teams thought would be a team that competes for a league title. Again, they beat the team that's going to win the league R.A. Long the first game of the year. And so to turn around and be like, all right, we got the three seed. Now what do we have to do? Oh, go stop one of the best players in the state of Washington,
right,
who the team hasn't lost with him in the lineup. So, wow, this last few games is going to be crazy. What ends up happening here? Good luck to both teams. You know, certainly an exciting game, an entertaining game, a whole lot of scoring, which we, again, yeah, like you mentioned, don't see a lot of at this level. So we appreciate everybody tuning in tonight. My name is Owen Frazier. My broadcast partner is Ty Stanley. We want to thank everybody for tuning in. Wish both teams and programs and schools the best of luck, and a good end of the school year to everybody.
Cheers.